Hi, Dr. Michael Mahan here from Psych with Mike. Today we are going to start a new project. We're going to begin working on the Space 1999 Eagle One transport. It has an MPC manufacturer number on it, or manufacturer label on it, but obviously all of us know this is from round two. So we're going to start from the beginning, and we're going to put this thing together and see what we get at the end. We're also going to be using some aftermarket parts. We have the Eagle One 1/72 scale Photoetch kit from Paragrafix, and we also have the Aztek dummy. Thank you, Lou, for everything that you do with Aztek dummy mass for the Eagle. And so we're going to be using those to upgrade our Eagle a little bit and try and add a little bit more detail. As you can see on the Paragrafix kit, we have a back panel for the command module. We have some window frames. We have some various little bits that go on the hull. We have some hatches, and these are the window frames, because what we're going to see, if you look here, these window frames on the passenger module that come in the model are modeled flat with no accents, so these will give us a little bit of additional accent in there to dress those up and make those look good. Now, Lou does give us the mask for this also, so that you can paint these with the window frames intact, and then if you leave his mask on, then you get a window frame also, but we get those with the Photoetch kit, so we're going to go ahead and use those on the Photoetch. We also have some seats for the command module in the 22-inch Eagle. They actually have a completed detailed interior of the command module, which the smaller 1/72 scale Eagle does not have, but we're going to go ahead and upgrade that with this Paragrafix kit. We're also going to do some lighting, but let's go ahead and go to the instruction sheet and start making our plan. Okay, so we are back looking at the plans for the Eagle, and what I like to do when I go into a new build is look at the plans and kind of decide what it is that I'm going to do with the build and mark some things out, because what I will do, and I'm sure that other people don't do this, Lou Dalmes from Aztek Dummy and Boyd from Trekworks, Augie from Interstellar Modeler, those are some guys, Chris from Chris Olson Models, those guys are the cream of the crop. I think all of those guys do commission builds. I don't know if Augie does, but I think he does. And I don't do that. I'm kind of a weekend builder, and don't have a ton of time. So what I will do is mark some things on my plans, because if I don't do that, then inevitably I forget what I had planned to do, and then I forget to do something or make a mistake. So what I want to do is take my Photoetch kit and my masking kit and use the directions that I have with those to kind of plan out what I'm going to do and where I'm going to need these different things. So I have my masking kit here, and as I had said earlier, this is the masking kit for the windows, and you see you get the individual masks. So you put this whole thing down and you pull these up, and you can paint your black in there. Or if you paint your black in there, then you can paint this white and end up with a frame, but we're not going to worry about that, because we're going to use these frames that we have on the Paragrafix kit. So some of the things that we get with the mask is that this emblem that we have on those landing pods, we can paint those on. So what we can do is paint our base coat black and then put this on, the mask on, and paint the white around it. And when we pull the mask off, we obviously have the emblem intact. So that's what you see here, is that we paint this side shoulder black, put your mask on, paint your white, you end up with your mask emblem remaining. So we have the same thing here on the bottom of those landing pods. You have masks for that. And then we have the mask for the command module, which will actually leave the outline of this white, which you see in the studio model. And we can do that also, but we're not going to, because we have the window frames from the Paragrafix kit. So I'm probably going to use the window frames here from the Paragrafix kit. And the reason is because if we now go and then the rest of these are just various masks. So you have the mask to use for the stripes for a medical pod, or you have masks that you can use to paint the command or the passenger pod orange and make it a VIP module. I'm not sure whether I'm going to do that. I kind of am leaning towards that because my favorite color is orange, and when I do my 22-inch, I haven't started my 22-inch Eagle yet, but when I do my 22-inch, I think I'm going to do that just as a straight utility Eagle, so I may make this one into a VIP. I haven't decided that yet. And then you get a bunch of additional masks. You have a mask here to paint that sensor dome. I don't know if we need that mask because the sensor dome actually comes as a separate part, so we may just be able to paint that part, and then when we glue it in, it will be silver, so that sensor dome should be a bright silver. So that is what we get in the mask set. Now, what we get here in the Photoetch kit is a ton of stuff, because there is no completed interior for this command module on the 14-inch 1/72 scale Eagle. But what we can do, we have templates here that we can cut out, and we can use that to drill out the top windows here, and then there's a window plastic that we cut out, and we can actually make our own clear windows, and we then have this interior that we can build, and we can make this into a lighted command module with a full interior, which is what we are going to do. We're going to make this a lighted command module. Now, with the hatches, you have different options depending on what you want to do. So if you're going to use this connector, this is a connector piece that puts the command module onto the service module here. And if you're going to use that connector piece, then you have to use these hatches here. If we make a full-scale hatch, then what we have to do is cut out some of the plastic here and make this into a full-sized hatch, and then we use the full-scale hatches on the service module. So I'm not exactly sure which of those ways that I'm going to go yet. I'm going to look a little bit more in detail at this, and I'm going to make that decision when I get to it. So I kind of have an idea of the things that I have and what I'm going to want to do with those. So now I'm going to go back to my main instructions, and I'm going to give myself some notes. So here I know that here I want to cut this out, so I'm going to make myself a note here that I need to cut that out. And that way, when I get to that step, and obviously that's the first step, so that'll be one of the first things that I'll do, I know that. And then here, I'm going to put myself a note that I have interior detail. Okay, so I've got interior detail here. I don't want to forget to put my interior detail here before I seal this up. Now, there's a couple of ways that we can seal this. We can seal this just by gluing everything down, or we could try and put a magnet system where we use some very, very powerful rare earth magnets on both sides. So I would put a rare earth magnet like here and here and then here and here, and then that will just hold that module on there, and that would give me access to the interior. Now, I probably am not going to ever need access to that interior, but if I wanted to do that, that would be an option. And so, but I know I want a light in here, so I'm going to make myself a note that I want a light inside of that command module. So I want a light inside the command module. So to start off with, I just wanted to talk a little bit about primer and starting your kit. So as you already know, when you get your kit, first, let me get a sprue. So this is a sprue of the kit as it comes out of the box. I know people love unboxing. As a psychologist, I'm amazed by the psychology of the unboxing video. I didn't do that. I think that there's enough of those videos out there that I didn't feel compelled to do that. But I didn't do a review inspection because this kit's been out for a while. There are plenty of those. What I will say is that the way that I have my parts arranged, there are four of these sprues. There are two sprues with the larger pieces for the landing pods, and then sprues for the engine bells. And I have those separated into their like groups because each of those just repeat. So I don't really have to worry about getting those parts mixed up. There's very few parts here that are going to be specific to a certain side or a certain placement, and where that is true, I believe that those are marked. So as you can see on this, they have, this may not come through on the camera, they do have part numbers on them, so we want to pay attention to what our part numbers are, but it's just really easy to organize them by putting them in like groups. So this is the sprue as it came out of the box. And the first thing that you want to do whenever you get a kit, you already probably have heard this a million times, is to wash your kit. So you want to submerge it in some soapy water. So I fill my utility sink with some warm water, put a couple of drops of dishwasher detergent in there, and then I use a brush to just kind of lightly go over all of the parts, and that's to get off any release agent, because that release agent can mess up your painting. And what you want to do is to create a surface that is going to accept paint. So plastic models are not a great surface out of the box for accepting paint. So when we were kids and we used to just get a kit and we'd open it up and, you know, the first thing you do is start spraying your paint on it, especially like car models, and you wouldn't get a good result, and a lot of that is because of not prepping the surface. So the first thing you want to do is wash the surface, and then after that you want to make sure that you're using a good primer. So primer gives a base for the finished coat paint, my dogs are going crazy, to bite into. So I'm always looking for a good primer, and when I got ready to start this kit, I saw this Krylon acrylic latex at Lowe's. I buy a lot of my primer there because it's fairly inexpensive. And so I got this and I used it, and I was not happy with the results here at all. I don't know if this is coming through, but my surface here is not particularly smooth. It's kind of pitted. The paint went on really heavy. This would be a great paint if you're going to paint yourself some outdoor lawn furniture. It is super durable. Once it's dry, it takes forever to dry, but once it's dry, I imagine you could hit it with a hammer and it wouldn't make much of an impact. But it's not good for priming plastic models. So this is another primer that I get from Lowe's. It's Design Master Primer Base in gray, and that actually works really, really well. So it covers excellently. It gives you a nice smooth coat to lay as a basis for your finished paint. And so I would recommend something like this. I know that every channel that you watch, whether it's Boyd or Lou or Chris or Augie, you know, everybody's going to have a different kind of preferred primer paint, and it doesn't really necessarily matter. You should use a paint that works for you. That's the most important thing. So you should try different things and use a paint that works for you, but remember, washing and priming your model is the most important thing that you can do when you are starting out. And so what we're going to do is paint everything in this gray, and then we've got some Vallejo surface primer black, and what we'll do is to go around and do our pre-shading with this surface black. And so what you want to do after you prime your kit with the gray is to go back and any of the deep detail, you want to go around that with just a little bit of black. And so I have a couple of brushes. I have a Pashy H. So for big surfaces, that's a great one. So hang on, let me get that for you, and I'll show you my brushes. Okay, I'm back. And this brush right here is what is called a single stage brush. It's a Pashy H. And or Pache, I don't know if it's Pache or Pache. And what that means is that this has a paint bottle, that paint cup that hangs down from the bottom here. When I push this button, I get air that comes through here, creates a vacuum, sucks this paint up, and mixes it here, and it comes out and in a single stage, in a single push of the button, as atomized paint. And what is nice about this Pashy H, first off, this thing is maybe 30 or 40 years old, and it still works as well as the day it was purchased. So airbrushes are pretty indestructible if you keep them clean, and if you don't do anything like bend the needles or things like that, your airbrush is going to work for you for a long, long time. There, if you have any kind of O-rings or anything, you may have to replace those once in a while because they obviously will deteriorate over time. But I use this when I'm spraying big surfaces. So when I sprayed this, I sprayed it out of my Pashy H because I wanted to cover large surfaces very quickly, and this is a great brush for that. And then for my detail work, I have a Pashy Talon. Now, you can look on the internets and you can find all kinds of videos about airbrushes, and so you should probably go online if you're not really well versed in airbrushes, and you should find some information and then try some out and find the one that works for you. But unlike this Pashy H, which has no adjustments, I mean, this adjustment right here gives you more or less paint. This closes this little cone on the needle or opens it up so you can get more paint or less paint. And you can change out the tips here to make your spray a little bit finer, but it is nowhere near as succinct or as detailed as this. So this is a double stage. The Pashy Talon is a double stage brush, which means when I push down, I get air. When I pull back, I get paint. So I have to push down and pull back. That's a two-stage. I have to push down for air, pull back for paint. That's a two-stage brush. And as you can see, when I pull back, that pulls this needle back from the tip here and allows paint to start to flow. And this is a gravity feed, where this is a siphon feed. So the Pashy H is a siphon feed. It requires the vacuum created by the air flowing through to create a siphon that sucks the paint up. This is a gravity feed. This is going to put paint through by the motion of gravity down into the chamber of the brush no matter what I do. So there's going to be paint there. When I start the airflow, though, that paint's not going to come out because the needle is blocking the tip. So the paint's not going to come out until I pull back on the trigger, and that's going to allow my paint to flow. So this is for really detailed work. So if I was spraying something like this, like this primer, I would spray it through my Pashy H. When I get ready to do the detail work, I'm going to use this Pashy Talon, and that's going to give me the ability to get into these areas and paint fine detail and not cover this whole panel. All right. When we get to that point, I'll show you what that kind of looks like, and you'll be able to see the difference in the way. Okay, so we're ready to actually start gluing some parts together. Well, actually, we're not going to glue parts together, because the first thing that we're going to do is work on our command module interior. So that's going to require us, and I'm going to check right now. So these are actually, both of these command module pieces are labeled as one, so they're interchangeable. There's not a specific way to put those together, so it doesn't matter which one of these command module halves that I start working on, but what I have to do now is to drill out the windows for the command module and start to do my detail work on my interior. So I need to get these out, and I need to actually bend these and paint my back wall interior. But what I'm gonna do is, in the video here, and I hope everybody can stay with me, I have a private practice and I teach university, and so I am really slow in my builds, not like some of those other guys that, you know, they are doing commissions, they are working every day and putting, you know, content out every single day. I'm not going to be able to do that, but I am going to try and be regular. But this part one is an introduction to getting the model cleaned up and getting some primer on it. And then the next video will be putting together and lighting the command module. So when I do that, when I start the work on the command module and I put that video out, I'll let you know where I ordered the lights from and exactly how I'm going to go about setting the lights up and running them to a battery that's going to be concealed inside of the model itself. But that'll be in part two. So I hope you guys are having a great day, and I will see you in part two. All right, so here is a little addendum. If you work with Photoetch, then it's really important to have a Photoetch tool, and I have not ever had one, and bending is really tricky, so I decided to get this Photofold, which is from Paragrafix, and it's the only Photoetch bending tool that actually is Photoetch. So we're going to put that together real quick before we end this video today, and that will give you a little bit of an introduction to Photoetch. So we were talking about this earlier, that we have this Paragrafix Photoetch set, and there are going to be pieces of this that are going to need to be bent. These are seats, and they need to be bent. So they bend along predefined bend lines, but you have to have either a tool to bend these, or you have to bend them by hand, which is really tricky and oftentimes very, very difficult. So it's always a good idea to have a photo etch bending tool. Now, some of those are really expensive on the internet, and then this one, actually, I don't even remember how much it was. I got it a couple of weeks ago and forgot how much I paid for it. But again, this is the Photofold 5-inch photo etch bending tool from Paragrafix. So the first thing that we have to do is to separate the pieces from the sprue. And with photo etch, what you have is these metal pieces that are attached to the sprue with little tabs. And usually what we would do is put this on a piece of glass to cut it on and then cut it with an X-Acto, but this is stainless steel, and which is much thicker, much heavier, much sturdier than this. I think this is brass, and so we're going to use cutters to pop this out, and then we will put it together. So get up close to see this, and I'm going to try and cut this as close to the piece as possible so I have as little residual on the piece that I'm cutting as possible, and that way the amount of filing that I will have to do will be minimal, which is always nice. The less filing that you have to do, the better. So this is our first piece, loose from the sprue. All right, so our photo etch is loose from the sprue, and then we have this leftover sprue. I usually don't ever throw anything away because you never know when something might be useful for something that you can't ever predict. So I'm going to put this back in my little plastic bag here, and I will throw this in my parts box and keep it just in case. All right, so now I need to get a file. Excuse me a second. While I grab some files. All right, so we're going to take a file. And we're going to file the little nubs that are left from cutting that off of the sprue down until those are smooth. And not necessarily because it looks better, although depending on what you're, you know, doing with the part, it might be important to get rid of that extra metal, but it's also extremely, extremely sharp. And if you don't file that down, then especially in something like this that I'm going to be using to bend other parts with, I could get my finger cut very easily without intending to by drawing it across one of those burrs. So you want to make sure that when you're filing this stuff down that you're getting it smooth. So I'm filing, and when I get it down to a point where it looks like it's gone, I'm running my finger across it, and if I can feel even more of a burr, or even a little bit of a burr left, then I'm going to go back and file some more. Until that burr's gone and I can't get my finger caught on it. Okay, we have our photo etch cut from our sprues, and we're ready to put that together. So there are, I don't know if this comes through on the camera, there are small teeth in this edge and then small teeth on this edge, and those have to line up. So I'm going to put my edges together and I'm going to slide this. So now what we have is this piece together. The teeth are lined up like so, and we are going to bend now this hinge, this keeper onto this hinge. We're going to bend that up, see if I can do that with my fingers, or else I'll get a pair of pliers. You want to be very careful making sure that that is bending correctly. And then I'm going to do that on the other side. Then we're going to bend down the feet. And if you get a pair of pliers to do this, I'll get a pair of pliers and show you that we can do that with a pair of pliers as well. I got a pair of needle nose pliers here, and that will make it easier to bend this. Make sure my teeth are all still lined up, and they are. And if I use these pliers, I'll be able to bend this much easier. So I can do it with my fingers, but if I use the pliers, it's much easier, and I'll probably end up with a better bend. So that's probably the way to do it. All right, so now I have a hinged piece of metal, and so it's not going to come apart because I've got my hinges intact and I can bend this freely. So then I have this top piece which slides underneath these guides here in the front. This piece can slide in and give me a flat edge right on that bend point. So I have a flat edge right on that bend point, so I would put my photo etch down on here and bend that up, or I can spin this around and I can have multiple different kinds of pieces that are different thicknesses. So sometimes you're just going to need to use something that like this to be able to bend a piece, and we can bend a piece that is of varying thickness. So that makes my photo etch bending tool, which is going to be something that I'm going to need when I get ready to build the command module, because I'm going to have some seats and then seat mounts that are going to need to be bent. I also have bending that's going to be required of this large hatch if I decide to use that, but we'll worry about that when we get to it. So again, you can bend photo etch without a bending tool, but it is a lot easier when you have the bending tool as a guide. So you can spend a lot of money on one. There's on the internet for tens of dollars, so $30, $40, $50. This, I don't remember how much it was. I'll check on that and I'll put the price in I'll put a link to the Photofold in the show notes. And if you want to pick one of those up, then you have already seen a little bit about how to put that together, all right? So I will see you guys in part 2 when we will be building the command module.